just when you think he's about to encase himself in a predictable cloak of political or public safety polarization, Tony Boza comes out with a sometimes shocking contradiction. First, he says he supports violence as a necessary element of policing, but immediately qualifies that enraging tidbit with a caveat that such violence must only be deployed and employed without abusing the privilege and completely within the law and constitutional constraints. Well, just this Sunday's front page story in the Star Tribune reveals what has been the issue for the last 100 years around here. The Minneapolis Police Department remains one of the most notorious nests of thumpers and liars and those who protect them by either covering up their crimes and misdemeanors and felonies or failing to report the transgressions they know are illegal. Despite $14 million in city council settlements over 7 years of police abuse, they will say, alleged, none has been thrown in out of their job like anyone else who has broken the law and their own rules repeatedly. And it's all but impossible to convict a cop of anything. Mayors and city councils, let alone police chiefs, no matter who they've been, have either failed or not even tried to bench these cops or kick them out for behavior that would otherwise have landed any civilian in prison, flat out. I only assume that these political types are paralyzed by fear, because many citizens actually like to see that cops are beating up bad guys. Oh yes, I've witnessed those people myself. Trouble is, they're not only not necessarily bad guys, but they're not only always not guilty. They're not always guilty about what these cops charge them with. And it's not the officer's duty in any event to serve as judge and jury when making an arrest. You can be sure of this: without consequences, a threat to your livelihood, your pocketbook, or your freedom, your bad behavior will be sanctioned and allowed, and more people will die or be seriously hurt. And most of them will be folks of color, especially in the cities. This is, at least in part, the essence of former Minneapolis Chief Tony Boza's latest recollection of cases, in which he has served as an expert witness, often for plaintiffs suing cops for behavior that should have landed them in jail. And Tony's but one of several former cops to come forward with the ugly truths about policing. Mike Quinn, another former Minneapolis police officer, has been on this show a few times talking about the same issue, as has Tony himself. This enigmatic retired cop has written a bunch of books, and his latest, Expert Witness Breaking the Policeman's Blue Code of Silence, is about as seemingly contradictory in viewpoint as he's always been. First, he opens his collection with this statement: I am an unapologetic supporter of the use of police violence, even lethal force, but it has to be guided by the law, the standards of reasonableness, and the U.S. Constitution. And he says he has presided over clubbings, shootings, gassings, and other assaults by the police. And I see violence as a weapon, he says, a key weapon in the police arsenal, and trained cops in the full range of possibilities available to us. My only caveat in that the use of force has to be legally justified, measured, and appropriate, and that the weapons have to be in conformance with the law. Well, if the record speaks for itself, much of the most serious violence does not conform to the rule of law, or the rules of engagement, for that matter. And is this all about recruiting men and women with an attitude who are left free to abuse those laws and rules? Or does this attitude and the racism that often accompanies it become inbred or bred by exposure and lack of consequences? Why is none of this accountable? How is it this blue code of silence protects cops and protects cops who should be reporting cops, but absolutely will not. Well, the very notion of such codes bespeaks a corrupting culture that may give a false sense of security to those who stay away from criminality or even legal dissent. But get in the face of any officer and you'll find the most innocent of democratic values may mean nothing to the uniform in front of you, one accompanied by a very large gun, a baton, and a can of pepper spray. It's hard to say if anyone else's stream of consciousness writing on such a variety of topics would fascinate as much as Tony's does, but it's an unlikely match at best. Indeed, he's authored four books, 1990's The Police Mystique, An Insider's Look at Cops, Crime, and the Criminal Justice System, A Carpet of Blue, An Ex-Cop Takes a Tough Look at America's Drug Problem in 1991, Police Unbound, Corruption, Abuse, and Heroism by the Boys in Blue in 2001, and 2003's The Decline and Fall of the American Empire, Corruption, Decadence, and the American Dream. And you talk about erudite. Before that, he'd written two technical books on police intelligence and police administration, and he's here to talk about all of this stuff again. Tony, welcome back. Welcome back to Truth to Tell.
Andy, thank you very much for having me on and for your wonderful introduction. It's great to be on KFAI again, and I think it is a wonderful, marvelous voice for the people. I agree with everything you've said, except the notion that Minneapolis Police Department is unique. Since 1989, I've been doing expert witness testimony, which mostly means blacks being abused by the police, sucking it up and suing, and their lawyers hiring me to testify against the police. I've had about 90 cases, 60 of which are in this book, and all over the country, every city. There is nothing unique about the Minneapolis Police Department. They are absolutely of a piece with policing in America, whether it's Los Angeles, Chicago, New York, currently sitting on a pretty big scandal that I talk about in an expert witness, the Central Park jogger case, which is still not... That happened in April 19th, 1989.
Yeah.
And no one still knows the full truth of that case. How many cops were promoted for framing five totally innocent individuals, all kinds of stuff. So the 90 cases described, 60 of them described an expert witness breaking the policeman's blue code of silence, available on Amazon.com.
Whatever and that is. How many other bookstores?
I ought to say whatever that is.
Whatever that is.
Since I'm a bit of a troglodyte. But it describes...
That's right. Folks, he does not own a computer. You should know this.
Well, or a wristwatch or a camera. Or anything else.
How do you function?
Or cell phone.
How do you function?
I don't.
All right.
That's the short. So the short and the long of it is that American policing is out of control. Everything you said is correct, but not as it applies to the Minneapolis Police Department, as it applies to policing in America as we speak.
I get that, but one of the things about our show is that the people who listen to it may be able to do something about the Minneapolis or
sure.
St. Paul Police Department.
Or they could move, only to discover to their dismay that things are exactly the same
everywhere else. Well, and then some people don't care because they're aloof from all of this. Let me quickly tell our audience that they can watch us live right now on livestream.com/truthtotell.com. Yes, that camera that Craig Stillmacher is pointing at you is feeding this live over online. So it's livestream.com/truthtotellmn, MN. Thanks to Craig. And then Or you can at least listen to us live at KFAI.org if you're having trouble getting us over the air. And we hope you'll call in. Yes, call in and talk to Tony or about him and his book. 612-341-0980. 612-341-0980. Our phones are open. Operators are on hand to take your call and your questions. Okay. Or you can tweet us at TTT Andy Driscoll, or post your comments on Truth to Tell's Facebook page, facebook.com/truth to tell. So let's hear from you. 612-341-0980. A conversation with Tony Boza is always a memorable event. So, okay, let's get. I mean, I know what you're saying about it's cops everywhere. It's all about...
It's the institution.
That's right,
policing.
The culture, right?
Absolutely. And it's not even the recruitment issue. They're not recruiting sadists and racists.
Well, so tell me about that.
Or thumpers. It's the institution that acculturates them into a brotherhood in blue. So it doesn't matter if you're black or a woman or a Native American or a white Anglo-Saxon male. They all look blue to the discerning eye.
Yes, indeed. If they're wearing a uniform, they're behaving pretty much the same way. Is that what you're saying?
They all behave the same way.
But why? Why do they get sucked in like that? In that culture, why do they become literally cruel in some cases?
Because we live in a very oppressive society. The overclass wants to keep the underclass out of sight and under control and unemployed and uneducated and in prison. And that tends to be blacks and Hispanics and Native Americans. And they hire somebody to do that, and guess who that is?
Sure, we talk a big game about getting everybody employed.
They hire cops to do that. No, we have no interest in employing the underclass. We have plenty. Try to get, we talk
That's
about...
That's why we don't educate them well, too, right?
Well, we talk about the educational system in America. America has the finest educational system on the entire planet, and certainly the worst of the... developed nations. How could that be? Well, you have one system for the overclass, and that's you and me, and one system for the underclass.
Speak for yourself, sir.
Right. one system for the underclass.
Yeah, we're all lucky. Yeah.
Weren't you driven up here in a Rolls Royce with a chauffeur? Didn't
I saw
see
that? You saw
I
that?
I got the wrong guy.
Oh, gosh. I'm sorry.
Anyway, the cops are hired to control the underclass, to keep them out of sight, them under control. Well, if you're assigned to do that, and that's your assignment, the oppressor is corrupted as much as the oppressed are abused.
That's true.
So
that is true.
Given that assignment, they respond predictably.
Stepping back into history just a little bit, it does reflect a little bit about how slavery and the conquering colonists here dealt with people of color and needed their labor, but certainly didn't need them voting. But they seemed to develop a fear of their own slaves, or they developed a fear of the people they were oppressing. And that fear feeds into a sort of hate and a sense of superiority. Would that be right to you?
Totally. You have to demonize the people you are oppressing.
Yes, yes.
And that's what it comes
down
to.
In order to justify it.
You become corrupted in yourself. And the cops understand this. It's not quite as egregious today as it has been in the past. In the 60s and 70s, they really were rioting in the streets. They were controlling the black community to the best degree they could. Since then, we have made some progress, and we congratulate ourselves excessively over it. But the reality is that if you go to Chicago and drive down Division Street, you're going to see tons and tons of black males all dressed up with no place to go.
Yes.
No education, no prospects. The only reason we're experiencing a dramatic and unprecedented peace bubble in America where violence is suddenly declining dramatically is because of Roe v. Wade, abortions, contraception, and welfare reform. That's the reason. And
that's why certain violence is declining, you say?
Absolutely. And New York has gone from over 2,000 murders a year to 500. A 300% decrease.
Really?
Simply because the teenage pregnancy statistics and the abortion statistics are reducing the population that traditionally has been feeding our prisons.
Whoa, you see that as a direct cause, eh?
I predicted it in 1990 that it would happen in a book called How to Stop Crime. Freakonomics, the book. Steve, whatever his name is, quotes me as being the only person who said that Roe v. Wade would produce a peace bubble. Now, why are your listeners disagreeing with me even as I speak? Because they're looking at the nightly news and they see blood and mayhem and horrific detail.
Oh, crime, weather, and sports.
But that's anecdotal.
Yes. Yes, that's right.
It's not a trend. Look at the trend.
But it's also a selective choice of what makes news and what doesn't.
But if it bleeds, it leads.
Anyway, that's right.
But anecdotally, it looks like the same as ever. But in terms of the trends, look at the FBI statistics for the entire nation.
You
will see that crime, we are at crime levels not seen since the 50s and 60s in America.
Isn't that sort of contradictory then? Wouldn't that say, then the police must be doing their job right?
That's exactly what the police chiefs are saying, but they're crazy.
Okay, why?
Because they're not doing any better. For 9 years, I ran the most aggressive police agency in the nation. We did stakeouts, stings, decoy operations, arrested thousands and thousands of people, broke all records on traffic stops and arrests. Mm-hmm. And guess what? For the 9 years I was here, crime, street crime, inexorably rose month after month after month after month. And finally, it occurred to me that there was sociological, economic forces at work that were impinging on the crime levels, and that the police were irrelevant to crime levels.
In a way, I've heard for a long time, and this was especially true when I was living in Detroit and what have you, that police essentially are, it's impossible for the police to prevent crime.
That's exactly the point.
They can only react.
That's exactly my point. Yeah. By the time a crime occurs, the criminal has been formed and the police arrest. They have a role to play, but they cannot prevent crime. That's right.
And they certainly can't solve the poverty problem by themselves or anything else. But people think that more patrols, presence
more cops.
More cops. Yeah.
That's why I wrote the book, A Carpet of Blue, meaning you carpet an entire community with blue and you still get crime.
Yeah.
I was shocked and disillusioned when I discovered that the police were irrelevant to the levels of criminality.
Were you really?
Yeah, because I believe passionately in aggressive police tactics, and I was shocked to discover it didn't work.
Well, you know, it is interesting to hear you say that. I think I've always expected you to be, you've always been, in my view, and I think around here, considered, there's that erudite chief again going off on his own tangents and running for governor and you know, and there you were. I mean, you were hard at it, and your incredible command of the English language has a lot of people baffled. I am in the English part of my world, and I don't understand some of the words you come up with.
You don't. I don't. But you were talking about another Minneapolis cop named Mike Wynn.
Yeah, great guy.
Terrific guy. Ask him what he did when he was in Minneapolis police. He was a decoy. He was regularly getting mugged.
Yeah.
That's dangerous. They don't do decoys because it's too inconvenient, uncomfortable, and dangerous.
You know, wasn't that what happened to that sergeant in St. Paul? He was really sort of a decoy and a prostitution thing that got him killed in the dark alleys of the
East
Side.
Yeah, I don't recall the details.
Oh, I'm trying to remember his name.
But
Vic, Sergeant Vic.
I've heard of it, but I don't know the case.
Okay.
Well, we had a woman who became a newscaster, Gail Plawacki.
Yes, Plawacki.
Plawacki was mugged around 200 times as a decoy. She would dress up as a little old lady and get mugged. And when I removed her from that position to appoint someone else, I said, my job is to redistribute the risk. I can't have you getting seriously injured. And some people would say, well, good God, that's the 250th mugging of her.
Oh.
So I said, I'm getting
you out.
That's
the end of that, yeah.
She threatened to go to the press to denounce me. That's how tough
she knew how to get around to the press, didn't
some
she?
Some tough woman.
Well, you know, it's interesting. Whatever happened to Gail Plawacki? We don't see much of her.
She worked at CARE TV and then became a kind of a public spokesperson for government officials. And I presume now she's raising a herd of cattle somewhere in some benighted spot in the remote hinterlands.
A wise decision. A wise decision. Well, all right. Well, let's start in a couple of your favorite cases in this book. The book again is, we're getting up to a time when we could take a break, I suppose, isn't it? Should we do that? Okay. All right. Well, if you've just tuned in, you're listening to a great conversation I'm having with Tony Boza, who is the former chief of police in the city of Minneapolis some years ago, back in the days of Don Fraser. Don Fraser was your boss, right?
And my hero, a great man.
Really a tremendous guy.
A great
He's
man.
He's still around. He's getting
decent,
on.
Decent, intelligent, hardworking, honorable, and never threatened by the fact that I was on the front pages every day.
Well, that's one of the reasons he was, he hired you. He wanted the heat off the mayor's office.
No, I'm kidding. He could take the heat.
Don would take the heat really well. He's probably the most calm and contained individual I have ever known.
You know, by the time I got to Don Fraser, I was old at Don Fraser. I had worked for so many schmucks in my life. I thought, God owes me this one.
Well, you got a beauty in him, I'll tell you. The really sad thing is that he couldn't have been our U.S. Senator in 1978.
Well, then I would have been unemployed.
Oh, that's right. Oh, well, thanks, Don, for losing. Okay. All right. Well, again, if you just it's Chief Tony Boza, in these last many years, a very prolific author on many of the issues he encountered in his many years as a cop and writer. In this case, his latest book is Expert Witness, Breaking the Policeman's Blue Code of Silence. And it's something we've talked about here before, but here it's really epidemic now, he says, not just in Minneapolis, but everywhere. Again, give us a call with your comments and questions for and about Chief Boza and your memories, if you got them. 612-341-0980, 612-341-0980, or tweet us at TTT Andy Driscoll, and you can try that, or post questions and comments on Truth to Tell's Facebook page, facebook.com/truthtotell, and so don't go away, we'll be right back. And right now, give us a call at 612-341-0980, 612-341-0980, or tweet us at TTT Andy Driscoll, or post a Facebook comment up at facebook.com/truthtotell. And let's take a call right away, Tony. We have a call from Eric in Minneapolis. Good morning, Eric. Is Eric with us?
Hello?
Yes. Oh, there you are, Eric. Good.
Oh, good. Thank you so much for having Tony Boza on your program. I want to commend him, first of all, for such sterling service, a true profile and character and courage. in my experience of over 35 years in Minneapolis and over a decade in the greater Boston area, he is the only police chief worthy of any respect whatsoever. So thank you so much for your witness and truth to power.
Thank you so much.
I have a two related issues that I would love to hear his comments on. They are, as I say, related, one enabling the other, I believe. Last fall, the Minneapolis City Council revamped the Civilian Review Authority, Police Review Authority, changed its title and makeup into the Office of Police Conduct Review, essentially minimizing, if not totally eliminating, the civilian aspect and essentially, as I say, throwing it into the police to police themselves, if you will. And secondly, yesterday in the Star Tribune, there was an article that was headlined, Minneapolis Cops Rarely Disciplined in Big Payout Cases, reporting that the Minneapolis paid nearly $14 million in reparations or damages for alleged police misconduct over the last 7 years. And in 95 of the largest payouts in that period, only eight officers were even disciplined for their misconduct. And so I'd love to hear what Police Chief Buzo has to say about
that. You would think you were a co-producer of this show. Thank you very much, Eric.
I'm a regular listener and a supporter, so thank you so much.
Well, thank you very much. And we're going to... Tony wanted to address both of them as I wanted him to. So go ahead, Tony. Respond.
Well, thank you, Eric. Unusually thoughtful questions. And I'm going to give you a flawed but personal answer. Civilian review doesn't work. What you need is determined reform chiefs. The trouble is reform chiefs do not exist. That's the problem. There is not a civilian review board anywhere in America that worked in terms of holding the police accountable. One way you might hold police accountable, and this relates to that article that you mentioned in yesterday's trip, is the indemnification issue. Why should the people have to pay these judgments? For the 9 years that I was chief, there were very few judgments, and one that was outstanding from before I arrived, I went to the city council and I said, why should Minneapolitans pay for this? Let him pay for it. Let the sergeant pay for it. He abused the people. I disciplined him for it. Now let's let him pay.
But wait, let me just interrupt for a second. The settlement... usually means that nobody's to blame. There's a consent decree. You don't, you know, nobody's admitting to any trouble. This goes on. The city pays out, but they don't.
But we can all see through that. That's transparent.
Well, we can see through that, but I'm talking about the legal side of this.
Why should they be indemnified? You could change their behavior overnight if you say, we're going to take your house if you act in bad faith. Every single case I took, 90 cases, expert witness book, 60 of which are there, every single case, I had to persuade myself the cops had acted in bad faith. Not they had made an honest mistake. The article in yesterday's Tribune was talking about police chiefs saying, well, honest mistakes will be made. These are not honest mistakes.
But police chiefs have been saying that for 150 years.
So why indemnify them?
Agreed.
Why shouldn't they be running the risk of being accountable for their own behavior? So they must be disciplined, and they must not be indemnified. And for the 9 years that I was chief, there were hardly any judgments. And you, as Casey Stubbs used
that?
To say, you could look it up.
Why is that?
Because I watched their behavior. I had a totally open system, and I said, anything you do is going to be examined. And if I conclude that you will behave badly, I mean, homeless people used to stagger into my office with complaints. That's fine.
Yeah.
My number was in the phone book for the 9 years that I was there. They would call me late at night. And I would investigate and hold them accountable, and their behavior changed.
All right.
Their attitudes did not change.
I think Eric was pointing out some stuff, though. Why can't we get to the core of accountability around the issue that if the city has, in fact, laid out a settlement instead of letting it go to trial or whatever, why? And I can talk about the civilian review thing myself because I was on the St. Paul Human Rights Commission when we started talking about building a civilian review board. But let's talk about why is it the accountability does not get to play back into the close the circle, as it were, in terms of discipline of police officers who have cost this city millions.
There are two reasons, and one of them is police chiefs. Police chiefs, who are they? Up from the ranks. They're
yes.
part of the system.
That's right.
In no way are they going to break with their colleagues. That's number one. So they're part of the problem, and they have no sense of accountability or holding people to respond.
Yeah.
That is the number one issue. And then there is, unfortunately, the malignant influence of the police union. There are two institutions in America that are tremendously valuable and useful, policing and teaching, and both of them are being subverted by unions that spend all their time and energy protecting the psychos, the thumpers, the unfit, the alcoholics, the chronic absentees.
Mm-hmm.
That's how they spend their time. Well, why is that? Well, they've gotten all the benefits that we're going to get. They have the vacations, they have the salaries, they have the retirement, they have the pensions. So now they spend their energies defending the unfit.
So we're back to accountability.
You can't fire anyone.
Why can't the politicians... why can't the mayor, who's actually over the police chief in Minneapolis, theoretically, and why can't the mayor, and in the case of this Minneapolis, the city council, which is really sort of all-powerful, if it wants to be, haven't they ever stepped in to call the cops into account?
Well, in this sense, Minneapolis is unique. In 1970, they took the president of the police union and elected him mayor.
Charles Stenvig.
Exactly. Uh-huh. And he was reelected twice.
Jeez. And I know.
The most corrosive, spoiled system you could possibly imagine.
Mm.
Friends rewarded, enemies punished, irrespective of any merit. That was the worst. That did make Minneapolis unique. But that ended with Fraser. Fraser ended that system.
But it came back.
It
came back in terms of the accountability issue.
The accountability issue was there before and is there now.
Yeah.
And as I said, for the time I was there, I say if I'm not persuaded that you have probable cause and articulable grounds for your action, you're going to be punished.
You spoke, let's just sort of, I think we've covered those two questions, don't you think, a little bit?
Yeah, I think so.
Okay. So, I could hammer on those two questions all day long because I thought it was really propitious that article came out the day before you and I had this conversation.
Yes.
But let's talk about...
And a damn good reporter did it, Randy First.
Yeah. No, he's
a
very
reporter.
Adept. Yeah. The drunken Indian stereotypes case. Now, a lot of people see this sort of going on very much like Driving While Black and other...
Yes, that's also part of the book.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
So let's...
There's actually a chapter called Driving While Black.
Oh, really? Okay. Yeah. All right. Well, I see that here.
One
oh, yes,
the
there it
chapters.
Is. All right. Yeah. Talk about this drunken Indian stereotypes, though, because I think that's a key issue in Minneapolis, especially.
Oh, sure.
Little Earth and all of that.
Well, repeatedly I had cases where the police were asked to remove a drunken Indian from a household, or a business, a street, and they would take him a few miles and dump him. That's what they would do. And in the case I cite in Expert Witness, they dumped him in a snowbank. And
is this the one where they crammed him into a trunk?
Right.
All right.
And dumped him in a snowbank. And if it weren't for some Good Samaritans from Minnesota Nice, he would have frozen to death.
Oh,
so, but sued and won. That was a problem I had not anticipated when I came to Minneapolis. All the other problems were familiar to me. The racism, the thumpers, the alcoholism, the psychos, the union. That was all familiar. What I had not been dealing with was a Native American population that I'd never had seen before.
Not a lot of urban Indians in, what, New York and Boston and places like that?
They're not very visible. They seem to be iron workers or something. And
yes.
That's about
yes.
it.
I'm surprised they come here to try to struggle as much as they do. But now we have Little Earth, you know, the Little Earth, the tribes, and they do amazing work here, by the way, amazing work. And
well,
a lot of great economic development.
Rudy Purpose deserves a lot of credit for giving them basically a monopoly over the casinos.
Yeah.
And he was a real populist.
Who was this?
Rudy Purpose.
Oh, Rudy Purpose, yes, he did, didn't he? Well, I always have this feeling that gambling may not be the greatest way to make a lot of money.
Oh, it's an evil.
Yeah.
It's an evil. And I told the governor that when he made me his gaming commissioner. I said, Governor, I don't approve of gambling. I've written against it.
Yeah.
I think it corrupts and addicts and all kinds of things. He said, just the guy I wanted.
Oh, really?
Honest to God.
Well, you know, of course, if the best governor wouldn't put someone like you in charge of, I mean, someone in charge of gambling that didn't want to weed out the corruption that can happen in that industry, right?
Why? I don't know why he. I think he just wanted. He wanted. I think more my so-called administrative or executive skills.
Okay.
But and he was perfectly content that, you know, I said I'll do whatever you ask me to do because I feel an obligation to do to function in government, but I disapprove of gambling and I will say so. Well, he said, that's okay. That doesn't bother me.
Talk about this very catchy little title called Life is a Sperm Lottery.
Oh, yes.
Would you talk about that?
Interesting little case. A six-year-old girl in kindergarten is uncontrollable. And because he has chosen the wrong parents. That's why I call it a sperm lottery. She made a very bad choice.
She did.
She was born to two complete and utter misfits, idiots, incompetents. And she now has behavioral issues, goes into the school, is kicking and biting and getting under tables and assaulting teachers. 6 years old, mind you. So they restrain her. And then they call a cop, and he restrains her and carries her away. She loses her shoes in the exchange, and carries her away into the station house. And they call the mother, and she can't come for whatever reasons because they're incompetent, and the father. And finally they get there, and they pick her up, and they sue. And I was hired to say that she had been handled badly, that the child, that's not the way to deal with a child. You don't have a cop carry her away to the station house. You do the best you can to safely contain her and call the parents and insist that they come to the school, and you deal with her as patiently and lovingly as you can. Well, they sued. But typical of their incompetence, the case just drifted into the neither fog of stupidity, and I never heard from them again. She chose the wrong parent.
She chose the wrong parent.
You have to be damn careful in the parents you choose.
Oh, boy, I can see why some people would really choose somebody
else. And they are to blame.
Well, of course they're to blame.
Of course they're to blame.
Look, they get knocked around because of it. Oh, yay, yay. Okay, and you speak in sort of general terms about rugged individualism. Talk about what that meant in this case.
Well, you know, you read about a cop and who assaults somebody atrociously, or Chicago case. I had they're listed in expert witness. Chicago had a series of terrible murders, and they had this dynamite detective, a bachelor, lieutenant, ex-marine, utterly devoted to his craft. Was the first one through the door, heroic. Everybody admired and adored him. John Burge. A black woman would be murdered. He would take some black male near her somehow, ex-boyfriend or whatever, bring him into the station house, apply a pincers to his testicles, and with a generator give him a jolt so hard that some of them had all their teeth loosened by their clamping down so hard.
You're serious?
He got detailed confessions over and over again.
Of course, of course.
Filled death row. Now, George Ryan...
The conservative governor of Illinois.
Just out of prison himself on a white-collar issue. Reviewed the cases that we were suing and which I describe, and they were being overturned.
And some people were being freed out of death row, right?
Dick Cheney should have been submitted to John Burge and his belief in torture. You can get anyone to admit to anything. He got detailed confessions, and George Ryan emptied out death row. He was so shocked and horrified by the people that were peopling it that he emptied it out.
Yes,
he just and Burge was sent to jail.
And they suspended all death penalties from then on for a while, at least. And I think they've since actually eliminated.
I don't know whether they did about the death penalty itself.
I think they finally did to get rid of it. But
he emptied out death row.
Yeah, it was an amazing statement to make. I mean, to do
it's one of the most historically stunning municipal developments ever.
Let's talk about as we close out this hour. Let's talk a little bit about the future of policing, the future of your expert witnessing. Do you think you'll ever be working yourself out of a job, for instance?
Well, I'm out of a job now. I've stopped. I'm too old to go on.
To even expert witness?
I think so. My son said, who's a lawyer, said, "Don't stop. Keep doing it. You're sharp as a tack." I said, "Who's going to tell me I'm past it? Who?"
Yeah, nobody's going to tell
exactly.
you.
Exactly. So I
except
I just
you.
Stopped.
Except you.
You know, like,
can you tell if like, you're? Are you losing it?
Well, I'm 85 almost. What am I, the man I was at 40? I don't think so.
No. Oh, God.
Nobody's going to tell you you're slipping. Quit while you're ahead.
Well, especially if you see it in yourself, why embarrass yourself or why?
Yeah. Well, Frank, I must be honest. I don't hear so well anymore, but otherwise I don't see any dramatic diminution. I continue to write and all of that, but I have to trust my own judgment. Stop now. You're ahead.
Okay.
Walk away.
What about novel writing? Have you thought about that?
I have written two novels.
Oh, have you?
About cases that I had, never published. I can't, and the answer is I can't write. That's the honest answer.
Oh.
I can't write.
Listen, I've got a book in front of me that says otherwise.
Well, this book I like because it's breezy and anecdotal, but my usual style is kind of pedantic and professorial and academic and desiccated and boring. And the only people who seem to really like it are insomniacs.
Well, I would join that crowd any day. Well, I can't, it really is amazing that you do write quite well.
Thank you,
but
Eddie.
You do slip in words that, despite my age and experience, I have to look up.
Well, don't forget I was born in Spain, and English is my second language, literally.
Yeah, I know. That's what blows me away.
No, that's what explains it.
Well, why?
Because you discover English fairly far along in life and discover its unbelievable charms and possibilities.
Oh, my gosh. Well, are you going to be anywhere that people can get your book, this book signed?
No, they have to go to Amazon.com, Expert Witness, yeah. Tony Boza, and no, nobody, you're not going to have any person who wants to talk about it, actually.
No, that's not true. but I must say that you should be out there signing these books somewhere. Yeah, out there.
I was hoping to make my fortune with this, but my hopes are dashed.
Oh,
so far,
you're gonna get the truth to tell bump.
If you want the economics of this, I probably have laid out so far about $8,000 on this book.
Oh,
and have received not 1 cent in return.
Oh, good heavens!
So that's where we are. That's okay. I'm not complaining. I'm just informing you listeners.
Well, the book is only, what, 19 bucks or something?
Something like that. Whatever it is.
It's not even that. It's 16 bucks.
I've still to see my first penny, but that's okay. I don't particularly need it. It's all right.
Okay. And most of this is just, you know, it was written definitely out of sort of your own memory and your...
I write for only one reason. I have to write. Something boils up within.
Really?
And it has to come out.
Boy, you're talking like a writer now.
That's why I write.
Yeah. Well, we must leave it there, my friend.
Thank you so much, Andy, and KFAI, for hosting me with this appearance. You're very generous and kind, and you do your homework. It's wonderful to be interviewed by a guy who's actually done his work.
Oh, gosh, thank you, Tony. It's always a delight to have you on. That's why, you know, we could turn this into the Tony Boza Show, but we're going to have to close it off there.
I've seen enough of the Tony Boza
Show. Yeah, right, and you're heading for the Cape anyway, so what the heck, right? Oh, have a great summer.
Thank you. You too.
Tony Boza is always a treat. Tony is author and commentator on politics and police, and is former chief of the Minneapolis Police Department. His book, Expert Witness, Breaking the Policeman's Blue Coat of Silence, is a compendium of cases where he's testified against other cops. Tell us where can the book be found other than Amazon? Anywhere?
Amazon.com under Expert Witness.
Yeah.
The book.
But Tony that's just Boza. About the only outlet right now is that
Who
you can
knows?
Buy it?
Who okay. knows?
Oh, boy.
I'm still a troglodyte.
He's a real marketer, isn't he, folks? Oh, boy. Once again, let's hope that the politicians of Minneapolis and other cities will step to the plate and stop this corruption of an entire notion of law enforcement, and that our elected officials weed out this continuing growing police violence. If not, is there anything else that can? I fear not. Okay, again next week we update you all on the Hennepin County burner, the garbage burner in downtown Minneapolis. Truth to Tell is a co-production of Civic Media Minnesota and KFAI. Links to podcasts of this and all shows, all of our TTT shows, are on our very own website, truthtotell.org, as well as for a few weeks here at KFAI.org. Thanks to this week's engineer, Peter Kerner, along with crew member Peter Hansen. I'm Andy Driscoll. Michelle returns next week. And as always, please, again, do take care of each other.